reach Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
Actually, it's Ghost to Ghost AM. And I issue you fair warning, some of what you're going to hear tonight is going to scare the hell out of you. So if you're alone on the highway driving, at home in a dark room, it's up to you. Stick around, and as you heard in the first hour, it's going to get rough. We'll get back to it in a moment. Here comes the first candidate. Okay, Art, it says, you asked for it. You have my permission to post the attached photo on your website as long as you don't release my address or phone number. I'm a student of religious demonology and help the local clergy when dealing with cases of possession. To keep my skills sharp, I spend a fair amount of time in cemeteries interacting with and photographing spirits. And here's a favorite from my collection. I was walking in a cemetery last night when I sensed a spirit telepathically beckoning me to follow it. I did so. And I was led through the cemetery to a freshly dug grave. Freshly dug. I took a picture and turned to leave when the spirit told me it wasn't ready. And when I took the picture, that is to say, when I took that first picture, so I recomposed the shot and waited for the spirit to give me some kind of cue. Shortly, I began to see something through the viewfinder, but it simply didn't register completely visually. It seemed to register in some other region of the mind. So I took that as the cue, and I snapped the shutter. I waited for the flash to recycle and took a third photograph, then left the gravesite to finish the remainder of the roll of film. And what he has sent me is one of the photographs on that roll of film. If you will check my website, I suspect Keith will have it up there pretty quickly. If you have a ghost or spirit photograph, you may send it to me tonight, and we will act with dispatch and get it up there just like that. My web address is www.artbell.com. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Heck was that?
What do you mean? What the heck was what?
Oh, I'm on.
Yes.
Hi, Art. How are you? This is Michael from Manhattan Beach in California.
Yes, Michael.
Well, my story goes back quite a few years. My ghost story was precipitated by a world event which I was part of. Let me take you back a few years. When I was just 17 and out of high school, I enlisted in the Navy back east. Went to Sampson, New York for boot camp, and from there, through some testing that they gave, they sent me to the premier radio school the Navy had, which is in Bedford Springs, Pennsylvania. I don't know if you've ever heard of it.
I've heard of it, as a matter of fact.
And it was the A1 class of the Navy radio school. It was a converted hotel and country club. And we learned code, we learned procedures, and we couldn't graduate unless we took at least 30 words per minute.
Right.
Now, FOX, which was the word for all the Navy information that was disseminated out of Washington, was sent at 18 words per minute. But out of Bedford Springs, you couldn't graduate unless you copied at least 30. And the top of the class, the 3.8 and above, fortunately, I was one of those, received the radio in third class rating upon graduation.
That's pretty good. I can't do 30. I can do on a good day 20, but not 30.
Oh, 30. We used to do 30 was the beginning. We used to copy at least 40, 50.
Yeah, you've got. I know there are certain crazed people who can do that.
Anyway, from there at that time in 1944. There are no more fleet assignments and submarine assignments. Everybody was assigned to the amphibious grouping.
Yes.
And from there, I went to Fort Pierce, Florida, and was assigned to an amphibious group. And what the radio men did at that time was to, with the LCVPs that carried the troops ashore, there was a coxswain and a gunner mate and a radioman.
Yes.
And that's what we were trained for.
Yes.
After a few weeks there, I was assigned to an APA, and we went to the Pacific.
Right.
Carrying on a bit, my ghost story was precipitated from a day that I'll never forget. Probably not a week or a day goes by that I don't think about it. April the 1st, Easter Sunday, was the day we invaded and landed on Okinawa. And we were assigned to carry the troops in waves, as you know. I'm sure you're familiar with it.
Yes.
To shore.
Yes.
Which we did. And it was kind of scary, but we did our job. And our ship, our APA, carried a second wave across. And by the time we were finished that day, we got back to the ship and hoisted the LCVPs aboard the ship, and we finally hit the sack about close to midnight. This is where my ghost story begins. About 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, we were all tired as hell, and I think when my head hit the pillow, I fell asleep immediately. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, I know it was around 3 o'clock, because I looked at my watch when it happened. Nothing startled me. There was no noise. I just woke up, sat up in my bunk, and there was... Oh, I forgot to preface something. One thing I hated about the amphibs, I couldn't handle the smell of the diesel exhaust. Kind of nauseated me.
Yes.
I never got seasick, but I just couldn't handle that odor. Well, anyway, I woke up that morning about 3 o'clock. I woke up to this sweet perfume smell, and I what the hell is going on here? One of these guys must have taken a bottle of perfume and dropped it or some damn thing. But then I realized, God, that smell is familiar. You remember how your old aunt or your grandmother used to splash that body powder over them, the bathing powder after they took a shower, and
it
smelled so sweet and,
yes,
and flowery.
Yes.
Well, that's the smell that I had, and I had my favorite. It was my favorite aunt's smell. My Aunt Melanie back east, God bless her. I could never forget that smell, and that's what I was smelling. The odor of the diesel fuel was gone.
And the air
was odor was prominent.
Yes.
And after smelling the weather, I realized what was happening. I looked at my watch. It was around 3 o'clock, and I fell back to sleep. And that was the end of the incident. And about 2 weeks later, I got a letter from my mother, who told me that my Aunt Melanie had died on Easter Sunday.
The
in
first,
the afternoon.
April the 1st.
And it was devastating to me, but I thought about it quite a bit. And then a couple of weeks later, I realized...
Yes.
What the heck is going on here? She said she died Easter Sunday in the afternoon.
Yes.
And I contacted my mother, wrote her, and asked her exactly what time she passed away.
And when you did the time conversion.
It was exactly at that moment that I woke up, when I smelled the powder, the sweet floral scent of the powder that my Aunt Melanie used to put on her body.
I appreciate the call, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. And what he just told you is very, very common. And it implies that when one passes to the other side, there is at the very least a period of time when you get to visit with or be near those you love. It's been in just about every movie I can think of that has dealt with ghosts and death. And I guess most recently, the movie with Robin Williams, What Dreams May Come. You don't go immediately. You get to console, or you get to feel, or you get to be with, or you get to leave a sense with those who you love. And I guess it doesn't matter where in the world they are, does it? On a ship near Okinawa, with all those time zone changes, or anything else. Because over there, there really is not time, nor is there space. So you're moving in a different realm. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Yes. I just wanted to tell you I really enjoy your show.
Thank you.
And I'm going to tell you about our ghost story. Well, one night my son was in his room and he had a friend and they called me in there. They were yelling. And I said, what's the matter? And I went in there and there was this shadowy figure underneath the bed with the red eyes.
And red eyes?
And it scared the hell out of me.
Under the bed with red eyes?
Yes. And like shadowy. And I was so scared, I called my husband in there, and he went in there, and he said, what the hell was that? And I said, I really don't know. And then my son just informed me that he has seen this again. He was in his room one night, and the shadowy figure went by, and he's also seen it again at my mother's house. It was in the shadows, and he threw a rock at it. So I think we're going to be doing a lot of praying in the near future, because I have no idea what that thing is. I personally don't want to see it.
He threw a rock at it?
Yes, and he said it just kind of sat there, and yeah, that kind of stuff really scares me. Oof.
Now, one could imagine almost anything, but one has got to admit that when it's red, glowing eyes, it's not a good message.
No, I would immediately think the devil, and you know, I'm a Christian and I believe in praying, you know, because things like that you don't want hanging around you.
Well, you sure as hell don't want them under your bed.
I don't want them anywhere.
I appreciate your call, sir. Wild card line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Art. How are you this morning?
Or
should I say this evening? This is Patrick in Fairfield, California, an old Air Force brat myself.
Yes, sir.
I just want to, first of all, give you all my best wishes to you and your family. I hope that whole thing gets worked out, too.
Oh, it will.
Yeah. I wanted to also tell everybody that we have a new Usenet group that's just been, it's 2 weeks old, I think, called ALT Binaries Paranormal. So anybody with good ghost pictures, we've got lots of great orb pictures up there and stuff. And
I've been collecting them over the years now. I've got some really incredible photographs on my side.
It's an interesting phenomenon. I certainly can't say what the heck it is, but...
One wonders why so many times the camera catches what the eye does not. That's really strange. Anyway, do you have a story?
Yes, yes. I wanted to relate to one of my many ghost stories that I share with my my friends on alt folklore ghost stories. Mm. Another great group. It's about an experience I had while I was working towards my degree in parapsychology at the sleep lab at Sac State in Sacramento.
Uh-huh.
And we were doing an experiment this particular night. We were mapping the stages of sleep using Kerlian photography.
Right.
It was eventually written up in the Journal for the Psychophysiological Study of Sleep.
So in other words, the Kerlian image changes with the state
changes,
of sleep?
Changes.
Well, that's something.
Not only through the REM period, but between REM and non-REM.
Oh, that's fascinating.
It was the first time it was ever done. Unfortunately, it was a pilot program. We didn't have much funding, and what it required was that my assistant Mike stay inside the anechoic chamber with the sleeping subject.
Right.
And he had to advance the film manually.
Right.
In between exposures, when I would cue him with a little light from the experimental room.
Gotcha.
And this particular night, it was about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I could actually hear two people snoring over the intercom. Mike had fallen asleep himself.
Bad.
I was wondering how the heck I was going to get him awake without waking up the other person. But we'd already gotten some pretty good exposures that night. But all of a sudden, I hear this movement over the intercom, and Mike uttering this low curse. And I was thinking to myself, oh, geez, there goes the entire night. You know, if he ends up waking up the person prematurely.
Sure, ruining the experiment.
Exactly. Yes. And as it turned out, it was going to be ruined anyway, because he yelled out over the intercom my name, Pat, and he goes, my God, you won't believe this. She's walked right through me. And I hear the heavy door of the chamber being opened and Mike's footsteps coming around the corner to the experimental room. And he goes, look at that. And he's grabbing my arm with about 500 pounds of pressure. And there in the wall from the experimental room into the chamber comes this kind of misty-looking stuff. And by the time it was halfway through the wall, just past the EEG, the old Grass Model 6 EEG we were using, was kind of it solidified into the apparition of, oh, I don't know, about a 60, 65 year old woman wearing a flower print dress, and she was just like floating with about ankle length down to the floor. You couldn't see her feet, and she just kind of floated through the very narrow long experimental room. And I looked over at him, you know, but both of our jaws were dropped, our the hair on the back of our necks were just sticking up. I've got goosebumps.
Yeah, like mine is now. Oh my God.
I mean, it was an incredible sight. And so when she passed through the shelving on the left hand side where we store all the EEG paper, just passed through as if it were nothing, and she never looked over at us or anything, but we immediately went around over to the left where there's another hallway. It was kind of a big U-shaped complex on the base floor of the psychology building, and we were expecting her to come through what would be one of the small little experimental rooms next to our experimental room,
right,
and then come out into the hallway. And she never did. So we went back around, and sure enough, there she goes floating back into the sleep chamber. And then we indeed went over to the right-hand corridor where she came through the anechoic chamber and disappeared out the outside wall.
Did the Kirlian photography that you were doing happen to catch any of this?
Unless there was an exposure being made during that moment, we wouldn't have known.
Is it reasonable to ask you whether you think the kind of experimentation you were doing, monitoring sleep, Kirlian photography, something very unusual, might have, in effect, opened a door that allowed all of this to occur, or what's your sense of it?
Well, she showed herself a second time, Art, but the experimental parameters during that time were a very traditional sleep type of experiment, wherein we were measuring the temporal regressive reference of dreams dependent upon the effect of alcohol and body temperature.
Yeah, but it may be that the very study of that sort of unconscious time...
Absolutely. I would have to tend to agree with you on that, yeah.
I appreciate the call.
Hey, thank you, Art.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I could not have handled that. Not at all. From the high desert, this is Ghost to Ghost AM.
If you could read my mind, love, what a tale my thoughts could tell. Just like an old-time movie about a ghost from a wishing well. In a castle dark or a fortress strong with chains upon my feet, you know that ghost is me. And I won't ever be set free as long as
Art Bell in. in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nine.
Actually, it's Ghost to Ghost AM. Good to be with you tonight. They've been good ones so far, haven't they? Listen, I was originally going to take the ghost photographs directly, but I'm too busy listening to you. And a couple of them didn't go through that I already sent to Keith, and I'm mortified about that. So, if you have a good ghost photograph, please send it right now to webmaster@artbell.com. That'll go directly to Keith, and he'll get it up. We're going to put up tonight's ghost photographs for you. And I had a particularly good entity photograph that I forwarded to Keith, and I wish to heck he had received that. I'm going to probably have to try and send it again. But for those of you sending photographs now, please send them directly to webmaster@artbell.com. And we'll get them up, the good ones, as quickly as they arrive. It's Ghost to Ghost AM. That's all we're talking about tonight is ghosts. And we're definitely, so far anyway, getting our money's worth. This comes from Tim in Phoenix, Arizona. Art, a contribution to your program. This experience took place 20 years ago, and I swear I get goosebumps when recalling this incident to this day. It was the summer of 81. I was a typical 17-year-old. I remember that. I'd sneak out after my parents were asleep, I remember that, and drive around with my friends looking for girls, of course. Not that we would have had the slightest idea what to do with them. Very slim chance that they would have given us a time of day, but I digress. After getting back home at about 3 a.m., I got out of my friend's car in front of my parents' house, waved goodbye to my buddies, turned around to head towards the front door. As I looked around, I was quite startled to see a man standing in the street between me and my parents' driveway. He was backlit by the streetlight behind him, so I couldn't clearly make out any features. I could, though, discern that he appeared to be wearing a long trench coat and a stovepipe hat. Additionally, he was standing next to an older-style bicycle. This is an extremely odd clothing choice, considering this took place in the summer heat of Phoenix. Now, bear in mind that we had just driven up the street directly over the spot where he was standing, and he was not there. I was scared because I assumed that anyone out this late, you know, or early in the morning, as you look at it, it was most likely up to no good one way or the other, hypocrisy noted, and quite frankly, I had a bad feeling. In an attempt to ascertain his intentions, I asked him, "Can I help you?" No answer. I repeated, "Can I help you?" No answer. He just stood there, kind of cocked his head to one side as if trying to figure out me as well. At this point, I'd had about enough, and I began to look around for something to defend myself with. Unfortunately, he stood directly in my path. I couldn't get to my parents' house with no alternative. I began walking toward him with my hand out as if to shake his hand in a friendly gesture. I got within a few feet of him before breaking into a full sprint, and I simply ran right past him. And I noted that as I did, it was very, very cold as I ran past. I didn't look back. Now, the next morning, my neighbor, who worked the graveyard shift, no pun intended, poked his head over the fence to ask me, "What was that all about in your driveway early this morning?" While I was somewhat relieved to discover that somebody could corroborate the experience, I was deeply troubled by what he said next. He said, "I know you're going to think I'm crazy, but after you took off running, that man got on his bike, pedaled a few yards and simply vanished. Well, my neighbor has been known to take a drink every now and then. The possibility of his being sincere and sober resulted in many a sleepless night. Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Hi.
How you doing, Art?
All right, sir.
I'm calling, listening to you from 105.1 in Las Vegas.
You bet. KVBC. Yes, Tony.
One day back in 1984, I was getting drowsy, so I decided to take a nap.
Right.
After several hours, I woke at about 12 o'clock at night. It was a particularly dark and creepy half-lit moon night. Mm-hmm. I had my window cracked when a noise rustling in the leaves drew my attention. I proceeded to look out of my window for a few minutes and saw nothing in the mostly blackened outdoors. I decided to go back to sleep, but for some reason I couldn't, and that's when I heard the fluttering kind of sound. That's when I decided to go outside and see what it was.
A fluttering kind of sound? You mean like a bird or something?
Yes. Yeah. But it was in the leaves.
Okay.
Carefully, that is, I grabbed a butcher knife. Creeping down my stairs to the side door of our third-story house, I rounded the corner to the garage, expecting a prowler to pop out from one of the many oak trees.
And having to use your butcher knife.
That's right. I continued onward, and I saw, with the aid of a neighbor's dim patio light, a thin 5-foot-high body of some kind with a gigantic head scurry from behind one tree onto the next tree. It went behind this tree as well.
Wait, let's slow this one up a little bit. A body with a gigantic head flitting between trees?
Yeah, it was scurrying.
Scurrying.
It was kind of scurrying.
All right.
And it went from behind one tree onto the next tree, and it was behind this tree as well. Not getting a great look at it, I proceeded towards the tree with my butcher's knife. When I got to the oak tree, I prepared for the worst, knowing whatever it was had to be there according to all the laws of physics.
Right.
So I jumped past the tree and there was nothing there. Whatever it was, it had disappeared. Needless to say, I got no sleep that night.
What do you think it was? What do you think you had encountered?
Possibly a demonic entity. When I was looking at it, it was backlit as well. But it looked like it was completely black, whatever it was.
Well, I'm glad for you that you didn't have to actually plunge a butcher knife into a demonic entity.
Well, that's not the end of the story.
Oh.
There's one more quick clincher.
Yes.
3 days later, I found a cat of mine that had been missing.
Right.
And it was completely degutted.
It was degutted.
Completely degutted. And it had a razor-sharp cut down right the center of it, and it had been completely degutted.
You're sure that in some sort of psychotic, unaware, unconscious moment, you're sure you didn't degut your own cat, right?
I'm absolutely sure of that.
And you connect the two events?
I kind of do and kind of don't, but you never know.
You never know, and horrible as it was to have a degutted cat, better little feline than yourself, eh?
Exactly.
Could have found you out there,
degutted. You got it.
Yeah. All right, sir, thank you very much.
Thank you.
East of the Rockies, you are on the air. Good morning.
Hi, Art.
Hi there, where are you?
I'm in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. My name is Joe.
Louisiana, as a general rule, is a very haunted place with many haunted cities, isn't it?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Mm-hmm.
The Myrtles Plantation is a really one of the most haunted houses in America. And my wife and I wanted to vacation there 1 year, but we really didn't have the money.
You wanted to go on vacation there?
Oh, yeah. Many people stay in the Myrtles Plantation overnight just to see if they can get a glimpse of a ghost.
Why? Just out of curiosity, why do you think somebody would pay good money to get the you-know-what scared out of them?
Human nature?
Yeah, it's some sort of comment on human nature, isn't it? Well, go ahead.
All right. The house that my mother lives in was built in 1974, the year that I was born. And When I was a small child, see, my sisters and my brother, they all told me this. When I was a small child, I had an imaginary friend that I called Sam, and I described him as a tall man wearing all black clothes with a black broad-brimmed hat and long black hair.
May I stop you and ask a question?
Sure.
I've heard so many stories about people, children that had imaginary friends. I never had one, and I've always wanted to ask. Your imaginary friend,
mm-hmm.
Could you see your friend? Was your friend an invisible friend, and you just had this mental image of your friend? Did your friend talk to you? What kind of relationship was it?
Well, I was so young that I really don't remember. I was about 3 or 4, and I was telling my brother and sisters about this, and come to find out, a couple of years after that, after I hadn't talked to him or talked about him or anything, my sisters and my brother, my parents, and a couple of friends were sitting in the living room, and this man, just as I described, my imaginary friend, nobody saw him appear, but he started walking through the living room in front of everyone and started walking down the hall. Well, my dad gets up to go look, you know, to see who's this man that's walking in the house, figuring it to be, you know, a burglar or, you know, someone that just was on drugs or something. When he got to the hall, the man wasn't there. Now, this happened 8 times in front of at least 3 people each time. And he's never done anything that you know, harm the family or anything, but my family all called him Sam because he was exactly as I had described my imaginary friend Sam. Now my wife, when she met me, she's a sensitive, and when she met me, she knew that something was in the house, and I haven't seen Sam since I was about 14, 15 years old.
Yes.
And she, when I called her tonight to say that you were doing this show, and for her to listen, she told me that she saw him go around the corner just the other day. Just walking, you know, like when you see someone go around the corner, just catch the edge of them.
Of course, out of
and
the corner
she,
of your eye, sort of peripheral
yeah.
vision.
And she walked around the corner, and he wasn't there.
Uh-huh.
And she didn't mention this to me until I talked to her tonight. And I wish he had, because I'd like to know what's going on.
Well, who knows? Maybe the next time you see Sam, it's going to be time for you to go.
Yeah, maybe. Also, my sister, one of my sisters, she says, she relates a story to me about waking up in the middle of the night and seeing like a Native American woman standing at the end of her bed that disappeared.
Oh.
And that happened to her, she told me, 3 or 4 times in that house. Well, when she moved to Germany, she was in the army, and she moved to Germany, was stationed in Stuttgart. She said that she saw the same Indian woman. And I talked to her about 6 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And she told me that she has seen this Indian woman everywhere she's gone.
Not good.
So she thinks it's probably a guardian spirit.
That may well be, and it may be that Sam is yours. Anyway, if you see Sam again, we're going to want to know about it.
All righty.
All right, take care. I don't know about the black clothes. Meet Joe Black, huh? Strange. Perhaps there are entities that remain with us all our lives, guide us through, and then when the time comes, take us out. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Yeah, hi, Art. How are you doing?
Well, it's starting out a little strange tonight.
Well, you asked for it.
Yeah, you're right, I did.
Well, anyway, I'm listening to you on 105.1 in Vegas.
Yes, sir, KVBC.
Well, this story, I'm originally from Hawaii, and there's a whole bunch of stars, as you well know. Hawaii's a hot spot for things
oh,
like
I
this.
Oh, I do know that, yes.
Yeah. And this happened while I was a teenager back in the early 70s, and we were visiting family from the island of Kauai, which happens to be the oldest island in the chain of islands out in Hawaii.
Kauai, yes.
And one of the spookiest. Well, as a child growing up, you know, I would hear tons of stories from families, you know, about this sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And it'll always happen in the evenings, and we'll get scared. And the next day when daylight's out, we're not scared anymore. Well, a bunch of our cousins, my brother and cousins and one friend, there was five of us in the car, that evening, traveling, just cruising around the island. And back in the 70s, there weren't many street lights. There's not many still today, but there's a
right.
lot more today.
Right.
And we decided to go out and have some fun because, you know, we says, hey, let's go call the ghost. One of the things they tell us in Hawaii that you never do is whistle in the nighttime.
It's whistle.
Like calling the spirit. You uh-huh. never do that. So we said, you know.
So
hey,
that's what you were going to do.
And that's exactly what we were going to do.
Figures.
And we says, hey, let's go down. And the place is called Spouting Horn.
Spouting okay. Horn.
And it's like the blowhole where the waves would come in. It goes up underneath the lava rock and it blows.
Oh, yes. Okay. Yes, I've seen it.
Okay. Oh, great. Okay. And anyway, it was there, and it was like a dead-end street. You know, you go up, and then there's cane fields around there. Mm-hmm. And so we went to the very end, and we were out there whistling, calling the ghost. Say, oh, here, come here, ghost. Here, ghost.
You mean, well, do the whistle.
Yeah. Come on, ghost, you know.
Like you were calling a dog.
Like a dog.
Because
yeah. it said don't whistle, and we said, ha-ha, that's just going to happen. So we have this one cousin of ours. He's a little skinny guy, and he likes to scare people all the time, so we thought we'd play a joke on him. And we told him, now that night we didn't have much moonlight, but you could still see, you know, silhouettes. So there was some moon, obviously. And we told him, he says, okay, you know, there's a big old tree over there by the cane field. If you walk to there and come back to the car, we'll give you a quarter. And so he's thinking, well, I know what these guys are going to do, man. They're going to dig out on me. So he says, okay, I'll do that. So he says, okay, go. So he walked. He disappeared. We couldn't see him. So we all jumped in the car, and we took off. We went down the street. We're laughing, you know. We're going down the street. So I turn around to see, you know, what he's doing, you know, if I could see my cousin or what's going on. Maybe he's running down after us.
Sure.
And I see, like, he's crouching over. Standing position, but he's crossing over. So I'm laughing. He says, oh, look at him. What, you know, what's he doing? And then my brother turns around and says, I don't know what he's doing. So we had a ball. We went down, and we drove like about a mile to the bottom of the hill towards the hotels, or that one hotel out in that area. And so we parked, and we get laughed, and we were talking, and we're saying how funny it is, how he likes to scare people, and on and on. And so we finally decide, you know what, it's been a few minutes, let's go get him. The gag's over, you know, let's just go get him and get out of here. You know,
sure.
We had our laugh. But the driver cousin of mine, he totally acted strange. And when we said, okay, let's go get him, Henry, let's go up and get him. And he just, you know, laughed in a strange voice and says, no, we'll wait some more. So we sort of chuckled a little bit and said, okay, we'll go along with him. Well, we asked him to drive up a couple of times, and when it came to the third time, it was really weird, you know. This isn't like our cousin talking, strange voice. Keep on saying no, let him walk down to us. So my brother, being the oldest in the car at that time, says, well, look, if you're not going to turn around and get him, I'll kick you out of the car, I'll drive the car up, we'll get him, you walk home.
Period.
So then he agreed, okay, we'll go get him. So we're going back up the road, and as we get closer to the end, we decide to turn the lights off to creep up on him. We shut the radio down. But we couldn't see him, so we sort of made the corner, and we were at the ledge, and you know, the windows are down, of course, and we hear this Hawaiian chanting sort of music.
Mm-hmm.
No instruments to it, and I know you know the music I'm talking about.
I of course I do. I've got about less than a minute.
Okay. Well, anyway, we get there. We find him sitting on the end, and so he's crying his heart out, you know, and we're sort of getting scared now, and we're saying, you know, come on, let's go, you know. My brother was a football star, you know, in Hawaii at that time, and he says, let's go, let's get out of here, you know, joke's over. So we tried to, he tried to lift him, he couldn't lift him, and my cousin, like I said, small, skinny guy as he was, we couldn't lift him. Well, when we finally got him in the car, we couldn't talk to him. Well, what we had to do to get him in the car is, I don't know if you're familiar with what the parents used to tell us then, if you have trouble, you swear and you urinate or whatever. Well, I try to do that when you're afraid, but we're swearing. We finally get him free. We're going down the hill, and we're trying to talk to him. He can't answer us, and we question why was he bending over and
real quick now.
Okay. Well, as it turned out, he said he walked halfway across the road, sat down, and as we ran towards the car, he tried to get up to go towards us.
Yes.
Something held him down.
Oh, and that's why you couldn't lift him.
We couldn't see him, but we seen the crotch and we seen the spirit. Well, after this was all over, we went to visit our grandmother the next day because she's into this sort of stuff.
And very quickly.
Okay, and she's seen a spirit behind him. Until today, you know, that spirit still haunts him. He has to wear this stuff that my grandmother gave him.
Wow. All right, from Hawaii, where lots of that kind of stuff happens. In the Kingdom of Nye, from west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network. All right, we're going to go back to it. Ghost stories. Ghost stories. Oh boy, are we getting some ghost stories. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hello there.
Yes, I'd like to say, first of all, I'd like to preface my call by saying that I've never really been a believer in ghosts, and I'm still not really sure about it, although I have found your show to be entirely entertaining tonight.
Entertaining, informative. Now, you say you don't believe in ghosts. You're a skeptic.
Yes.
However, something obviously happened to you.
Yes. I am familiar with electronics, and an incident about 12 years ago. I'm 28 years of age, and when I was about so old, still to have the mind open, I was sitting at my kitchen table, and back then you had the kids around the neighborhood, and we had quite a few kids in the neighborhood who would come around and ring the doorbell, myself included.
No, I used to do that too.
And run away, sure.
Sometimes with a lit dog poop bag.
Sure. I've never pulled that stunt quite, but yes.
It does work. I mean, the homeowner runs out, of course, and it stomps it out, and the result can be imagined.
I imagine. I would imagine. Well, needless to say, there was a short in the doorbell. This had happened before, and there was a humming in the kitchen where the speaker was.
Mm-hmm.
And my father took apart the speaker part of the doorbell in the kitchen, and not only was the speaker off, but the wires were hanging down for my friend and I both to see. They were all hanging there. The
gotcha.
You know, the hot lead, the cold lead. And
right,
the,
sure.
Yeah, and the
just the bare wires.
Right, and they were all hanging there. Well, we used to joke about ghosts in the house, and there were, of course, your creaks and everything else, and the wind closing doors, and we just happened to be joking about ghosts that night, and that doorbell rang.
The doorbell rang.
The doorbell rang.
Without
with no wires attached. There were no wires attached.
Are you sure you heard the doorbell?
Am I sure I heard the doorbell?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm pretty damn sure I heard that doorbell.
Okay.
Because this is nothing like I've ever heard before. I mean, it was the doorbell. And we both looked at each other, and it was a hair-raising thing. chills ran up and down my spine. Now, I've never believed in ghosts, and I really still don't, and, you know, I can't believe there was...
So you do have an explanation, then?
No, I have no explanation.
No explanation.
But I still can't. I can't believe that you know, another entity was responsible for it. Although, you know, you would have to be ignorant to believe that there was not something else out there. So
precisely, sir. I appreciate the call. Indeed, you would have to be ignorant to imagine that it's all over. There's nothing out there. Well, there is something out there. And if you listen, as you listen during the night, you will become convinced yourself, if you have not, by personal experience. Of course, all the questions are, what is it that's out there? And if it is us, where are we? Heaven, hell, somewhere in between? Why have we not gone elsewhere? Why do we remain? Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Yes.
This is Frank in Treeport, Louisiana.
Down in Louisiana again. Yes, sir.
And I'm a longtime Civil War collector of relics and have walked the battleground at Pleasant Hill for 25 years. And the doctor who owns the land, we built a kind of an extensive museum by finding artifacts. And all this time, for the last 25 years, we began running into strange happenings on the battleground. This old log house was used as a hospital during the battle and afterwards. And we had the commander of the Civil War reenactment. He was going to stay in the old house overnight to be on the scene early in the morning, and he had a lantern in there, and his daughter had put up a cot, and he was getting ready to go to bed because he had to get up early and command the reenactment the next morning.
Right.
And of course, they had Civil War reenactors everywhere, but he said he was getting late and he wanted to go to sleep. And he said he didn't want to be disturbed. He told the rest of the reenactors to stay out. And all at once, this ragged Confederate came in with straggly hair and beard and said, "It's your turn to take guard duty." And it irritated him real bad. And he said, "I got to command the battle tomorrow. You go do the guard duty." Mm-hmm. He says, "No. I'm tired. It's your turn." And that he laid down where onto the cot where his daughter was laying asleep, and he dissolved where into the cot where his daughter was, and it shook him up pretty bad.
Yeah, that would do it. That would definitely do it. Now, battlefields...
Yes.
Battlefields have long been extremely haunted places for obvious reasons.
Let me tell you one more if we have time. We had a New York boy that came down from up here, and I had hunted the battleground extensively, and the 173rd New York had used a ditch there to fight hand-to-hand combat until they were wiped out. And so I, of course, used metal detectors to find the relics, and I had hunted this ditch for about 5 years and found everything that could be found.
Right.
And he said, "Can I go with you? I would love to go since my kinfolks..." Now, he was from up north, and of course, I live in the south, and it's kind of unusual that way, so
mm-hmm.
He went down there. He didn't know where he was. I didn't tell him where he was, and he found a beautiful brass spur right next to the ditch where the 173rd New York were completely wiped out. So it was a hot day, and we laid down in the ditch, and I never get any feelings like that. I don't know why, but he does, I guess, and he laid down in the ditch, and he didn't know all his kinfolks had all been killed in the ditch we were laying in.
Oh, my.
And all at once, Art, he just jumped straight up out of the ditch like something stuck him with a hot poker. And he said, "Something just passed over me." He said, "I've got to get out of here. I've got to go." And I laughed, and I knew he didn't know where we were. And so I said, "Oh, John, just... lay back down. Just because all your kinfolks all got killed right where you're laying is no reason to get upset." He jumped out of the ditch and sat down in the old road, and I had to have a little fun with him. I said, "John..."
Southern fun. This is Southern fun.
Yeah. And so I said, "John, you just sat down in the old Civil War road. I said, pretty soon a caisson pulled by horses and a cannon will come roaring down the road, but don't get out of the way. It'll just pass on through you. Well, he was thoroughly shook because he was really nervous already and had something bothering him continuously. And that, he didn't know what to say to that, so I had to pull his leg a little more, and I said, pretty soon you'll hear the bugles blow, and it'll be time to leave. And he was so upset by then, we were a mile from the car on the road, and he couldn't contain himself. He said, something's here with me. I've got to go. I've got to go. And I said, no, John, wait till the bugles blow. And a coon hunter blew up one of these old fox horns at that time. And John left that woods, leaving a trail of smoke all the way to the car, and I walked him out up there, and he was scared to death sitting on the hood. And he said, something was in that ditch with me. He said, I know it, I know it. And I said, and you couldn't even let me get in the car. He said, you had it locked.
Well,
so you got a real fun thing out of that.
Yes, well, now I've had a little taste of a Southern sense of humor. Great. His whole family was killed in the ditch. And he felt something pass directly over him. And you didn't tell him. And you were having fun with him. Great sense of humor. Great. Maybe they just take those things for granted down there, huh? East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello. Hello there?
Hello?
Yes, hello.
Oh, it's me.
Only you'd know that for certain, but it sounds like you.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
I have a ghost story.
All right. Where are you?
I'm in Texas, Austin.
Austin, all
right. Right now. But the ghost, the resident ghost, was living with me on Long Island. And my son was about 3 or so. And he wanted, we had a pull-down attic door, and he wanted the Jeep I had hidden for him for Christmas.
Yes.
Up there. And I said, how do you know what's up there? He said, well, Irving takes me up there.
Irving.
I said, who's Irving? He says, he visits me at night. And I said, well, how do you get up in the attic? Does he pull the door down? And he said, no, we float up through the ceiling.
Through the ceiling.
And, in days to come, Irving had taken him to where Irving lives, which was a box of bones in the ground.
A box of bones in the ground?
In the ground.
Through the ceiling to get to a box of bones in the ground?
Yes.
Okay.
So, in days to come, we had an occasion to walk through the community cemetery to see the Memorial Day parade.
Lots of bones.
And as we're walking through the cemetery, he pulls at me. He says, Mommy, Mommy, there's where Irving lives. And I go over to where he showed me.
Yes.
And it was Irving Riggs.
Oh, my God.
So,
you mean it said it right there?
It said it right there on the gravestone. So I had, I worked for 30... So
oh, excuse me, but you know, this really sucks. I mean, I don't like graves. I want to be cremated. I don't like bones. I don't like things buried under the ground. And the last thing in the world I'd want is to be in a box with bones and Irving.
Well, that was Irving's bones. But I asked him, I said, does it, you know, weren't you afraid? He says, no, Irving talks to me.
Yeah.
He said he was afraid at first. But now, there was a question earlier this evening. You said to somebody, does this child see the person?
Yes, yes, oh yes.
Well, I have that answer for you.
And it is?
Well, I worked for years with a girl by the name, whose maiden name was Riggs. So I told her, I said, Edna, do you have any ancestors by the name of Irving? She says, yes, a great-grandfather. So I told her the story. And, in quite a few years to come, then, she said her aunt had died, and she went over to help her take the stuff clear the attic out, and a picture fell out of a box she was carrying down from the attic, and she asked her other aunt, who is this?
Yes.
And her other aunt said, that's your great-grandfather Irving. And so she gave me the picture.
Yes.
And now my son's in his teens, and he hasn't seen Irving, and Irving has just, you know, turned water on, and we always say, oh, it's Irving. Things have fallen off the wall, there's footsteps, and so when I came home from work and I put the picture on the bulletin board by the phone, my son comes running in from work or something, and he grabs the phone to call his girlfriend, And he stops short. He hangs the phone up. He says, "Mommy, where did you get that picture? Who's that picture of?" I said, "I don't know." I said, "Who does it look like?" He said, "Remember that guy who used to come visit me?"
Oh, man. Oh, God. So there's not much question about the fact that, at least in your son's case, he sure saw Irving.
And Irving was a real person, a real ghost.
Oh, man, what a story.
We put a face to Irving. I wanted to tell you this story.
Better face than bones.
I think he was better looking in the picture.
No doubt. All right, my dear, thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right, oh, no, thank you. I don't like that one. I don't like that one at all. Can you imagine being taken in the night by a spirit to the place underground where the body, what's left, is buried, to spend time with the spirit there? No, thank you. West of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Hello?
Yes, hello.
Hi, how you doing?
I don't know. I was doing better earlier. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm fine. I'm calling from Sacramento.
Yes,
California.
Sir. Yes, sir.
I was privileged to live in a house that my grandfather purchased, got in the 30s. He bought the land, and he built it up. He built it by hand, and basically by cement. He was a cement mason. And over the years, he traveled during the war. My grandmother, they traveled around, doing contracts for the government, building, air bases and stuff. Well, they finally planted themselves on this piece of property. And my grandmother wouldn't move. Well, my grandfather passed away in the late 70s, and I came home and leave and saw him. And the night he passed away, we talked. Then my grandmother passed away in the late 80s. And me and my girlfriend decided, well, we'll move into the house. Now, this house was built by a bunch of drunken cement masons. So there was add-on.
A bunch of drunken masons?
Yeah, cement masons.
Cement masons.
And my dad and my uncle, they made the bricks by hand. My grandfather loved cement.
Yeah.
And he would cuss every time he said that house I built, I made 100,000 of these bricks. Well, over time, I moved in, I was a nurse, and I worked at night, and I lived in South Sacramento. And over time, the area deteriorated, but the plot of land we had and the house was there.
Right.
When we first moved in, things would start to happen. A light switch. We had these distinctive light switches. My grandfather was a scrounger. And if he could get it from a military base, he'd get it.
Uh-huh.
These lights would go click, click.
Right.
Click, click. And we'd be sitting in the living room, and there was a lot of stuff left over from them, but you'd sit there and suddenly hear a click, click. And the bathroom in the back bathroom would come on. The door would kind of jar, and then the toilet would flush. Click, click. Light would go off. These small things went on. You'd get cigar smoke. My grandfather was an avid cigar smoker.
Listen, sir, I'm going to interrupt your story, and we're going to finish it after the break. Is that all right?
Okay.
All right, stay right. Click, click. Bones in a box. Irving taking me to visit. You've got to be kidding. Listening to Ghost AM. I'm Art Bell.
Run in the shadows, damn your love, damn your life. And if you don't love me now, we'll never love me again. I can still hear you saying, we'll never break the jam.
I was a highwayman, along the coach roads I did ride, with sword and pistol by my side. Many a young maid lost her baubles to my trade. Many a soldier shed his lifeblood on my blade. The bastards hung me in the spring of 25. But I am still alive.
I was a sailor. I was was born upon the tide. With the sea I did abide. I sailed a schooner around the Horn of Mexico. I went aloft to furl the mainsail in a blow. And when the yards broke off, they said that I got killed. But I am living still. I was a dam builder across a river deep and wide, where steel and water did collide. A place called Boulder on the Wild Colorado. I slipped and fell into the wet concrete below. They buried me in that great tomb that knows no sound. But I'm still around. I'll always be around, 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 around.
Call Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
But I will remain. I'll be back again.
And again. And again. Good morning, everybody. We're telling ghost stories this night. It's called Ghost to Ghost AM. We'll get right back to it. I wonder if some cruise ships are haunted. One would think so. There certainly are some planes that are haunted, and here's my caller once again, sir. Please continue.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
Back. Yeah, before I go on, I just want to, that Sea Crane Company, I found them very amicable and very easy to deal with, and I will purchase many more things from them.
Thank you. You're right. They are.
Yeah. Where were we at? We were at my grandfather's house.
Yes.
Yeah. He was a character, but as I say, he loved his cement, and he would get friends to do things for him and build things. And the house started off with one room, and then they added on. Well, over a period of time after they passed away and my girlfriend moved in, things, you know, started happening. You know, cigar smoke, you could smell it. You can, you know, fried chicken, lights would come on and off. You'd be sitting there, and you'd get a whiff of my grandmother's perfume, or you'd get a cold breeze by your head. Nothing demonic. It was fun. It made you feel good. And my girlfriend would be home alone, and she'd be sitting in the garage room, which was where my grandmother spent most of her time. She'd say, "Dang it, Mike, she's back." And she'd say, "She's in here. She's turned the TV on and off a couple times," and she'd laugh. But then things would start to happen. My grandfather had a cement shed where he did all his work for his pots and stuff, and we were one night sitting in bed, and we kept hearing this noise. And it was the cement mixer going around and around.
Oh, my.
And we got it, went outside. Of course, it's not there anymore, but we kept hearing, and then you hear shovel scoops.
Yep. Don't you realize, though, the potential horror that you're talking about? In other words, dying, being so attached. I can understand being attached to the work you have done, the stonework you have done, the house you live in, the area you're in, your plot of land, whatever it is. I can understand that, but the hell of being forever more confined, unseen, to roam in these places, it's horrible to contemplate.
Yeah, well, I understand that, and I felt for him. So we would talk to him. I'd be sitting there working, and I'd say, "How you doing?" And I worked in his office. I lived there. I was actually lucky to live there for about 3 years. And the final kind of chapter in all this, my girlfriend and me were having a bad night, and we woke up suddenly. And she got up, and I got up. We walked outside in the living room. All the chairs were upside down. The property was being sold. So they, I think, were upset that they were losing their house, because this was a hub of our family.
No, that's right. No, no.
Years.
I understand the chairs were upside down.
Right. And so then, finally, I was tasked, my girlfriend was taking a bath. She felt the door open,
and then she felt her hand on her back. Well, that's it. She got up, went out, dried off, got up, and went, well, the light went on, toilet flushed. There it is again. I got tasked to cleaning out the pump house, we called it, and there was a lot of stuff in there. And we were selling the property, so we had to clean up the, you know, what's left over.
Right.
And this is kind of emotional because this was, I cleaned it all out, and I was throwing, my grandmother was a pack rat, everything. Well, I got done finished cleaning it out, and there was this shelf that I hadn't, that had been cleaned off, but it had just been sitting there.
Right.
And I went out finally to get the last load, and I looked up, and there were these two cars. They were those little die-cast pot metal cars from the,
oh, yes,
from the 40s.
Right.
And, whoa, that's interesting. They were just sitting there. It was a red one and a green one. And I looked at them and said, where'd these come from? So I picked them up and I took them into my girlfriend. I said, what, are you messing with me again? You know, because we used to play tricks on each other. And she said, no. And she kind of turned kind of white. She said, where'd you get those? Mm. I said, out in the shed. And she says, I thought I felt something out there. Well, the cars turned out to be my father's when he was a kid. And I guess my grandmother wanted to have them because we were throwing all this stuff away, and they turned back up. My dad kind of got teary-eyed. He said, I haven't seen these in 30 years. Oh. So, unfortunately, the property was sold, and things moved on. And I think they're still there. I don't think they're happy. I hope, you know, there was a lot of other things that went on, but it wasn't an evil thing. It was very, very, very pleasant to be there.
I understand.
And I really enjoyed it.
Well, I've enjoyed your story, and I'm going to amplify on it a little bit. Thank you very, very much. If you're very young, you won't comprehend what I'm about to say. But as you get older, a place that you have built yourself, a place that you have designed yourself, your own property, your own place, would and does carry such a very, very strong imprint on your mind that I can imagine, I can easily imagine that if there is some sort of existence, be it heaven or hellish after this life, you would not easily, nor perhaps ever, in the real horror of thinking about it, detach yourself from this place that you were so connected to, that you so loved, that you knew every cranny and crook of that you loved, you know, your place, your home, that you remain there. But that's quite a prospect to consider, isn't it? First time caller line, you're on the air. Good morning.
Hi, my name is Bob. I'm from Alameda, California.
Hello, Bob.
Yeah, and I live on an island. It's called Alameda, and the significance of that will come up later.
All right.
But I'm a commercial pilot. And in January of 1998, I was working on building hours, building cross-country hours.
Right.
And so I flew.
You fly, do you fly big jets?
No, I fly the small little airplanes. I'm still building up hours, going to do my certified flight instructor rating.
Gotcha.
But off of that, we'll go up to, I was going to fly up to Ukiah. And I flew up there and visited with my friends, and it got kind of late. So I started to fly back, and it was about 11:30 at night. And as I left the airport area, it was about 3,000 feet, and all of a sudden it got really, really cold in the cockpit. I was like, man, this is real cold.
In the cockpit?
Yeah, in the cockpit of this little 172 Cessna.
Mm.
And so I reached up and closed the vents, and I pulled on the heater, and it just stayed really cold. And I didn't think much of it, and I listened to a station called 960. It's an old 40 station. And I had that going on, and they were playing the old music. And all of a sudden over my headsets, I hear, check your six, boy. And I was all by myself in the cockpit, and the communications radio, I didn't even have that on.
Yes.
So I turned around and looked behind me, check your six, look at your 6 o'clock position.
Right.
I turned around, and all of a sudden there's just this kind of glowing green light, and it's getting closer and closer.
Oh,
and I was like,
God.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, my
man.
God.
Oh, God.
Yeah. So
what was the voice like?
It just sounded like some old 40s voice, you know.
Check your six.
Yeah, check your six, boy, is what he said.
Yeah.
And I turned around, and this light was getting closer, and so I go to turn and push forward, and the yoke wasn't moving. And these little planes aren't equipped with autopilots. And this thing was not, you know, not pitching down and not turning or anything.
You couldn't change anything.
I couldn't move after that. And all of a sudden, the lights dimmed in the cockpit, and I'm getting real scared.
I hear you. Yes.
And so then I kind of get fixated on this thing coming up behind me, and it, as it gets closer, it had a, probably another, you know, I'd say 60 or 70 knots on me, and it was creeping up, and it went around on my right side and came up to about my 3 o'clock position.
Yes.
And I'm looking at it, and it's a huge flying boat. One of the old Pan Am-type clippers had pulled up alongside me.
You've got to be kidding.
Oh, God, I'm not. I wish I was, because it's really scared the heck out of me.
You swear as a pilot to be... This is true?
I can't lie.
All right, go ahead.
I don't tell people about this because they'll think I'm crazy, but I figured I'll go ahead and call. Anyway, this thing pulls up beside me, and it's starting to creep in, and you know, I'm really frantically trying to get this stick to move, and I just look over, and all of a sudden I just see this face in the cockpit window, and this thing's huge, you know, 4 big radial engines.
Yeah.
And the guy kind of gives me a wave, and then he turns off and pulls away. And then all of a sudden it just kind of vanished, you know, and then I could start to hear things again, and I could hear the radio again. So I made it back to Oakland Airport, where I'm based out of.
Yes.
And I landed there, and my mom had bought me this book a couple weeks earlier, and it was called, I got it right here, it's Pacific Pioneers Pan American Story. And I just was curious, and I was looking through it, and there's one name called, it's an M-130 Philippine Clipper. It's a Martin flying boat, and it had crashed on January 21st, 1943. It crashed up in the Ukiah area, and I was like, "Wow, that's really amazing. Maybe that was the same one I saw." And then, I didn't think much of it after that. And then I was riding my bike up at the old Naval Air Station in Alameda, and it turned out that Alameda was the base for the Pan American Company for their Pacific flights.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I could not believe it, but yeah, it happened.
So, you had a mid-air encounter with a ghost plane.
Yeah, and ATC, I queried him on my way in. I said, "Do you have someone? Have you seen any planes around me on your radar?" And they said no, and I didn't really want to press the thing. I was kind of worried I might have a phone number to call when I got back from the FAA.
Definitely, you wouldn't want to tell that story.
No. So I kind of say, keep it under your hat and all your millions of listeners, too.
We'll do that, sir.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you. But what does that tell us? What hints do we derive from that story with respect to... things that are gone, dead, gone. Was it the plane itself that was in some slip of time or dimension suddenly there again? Or the occupants of that plane that had crashed? Whoa, what a story. Check your 6 o'clock, boy. Wild card line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, this is Steve in Fort Walton Beach.
Hello there,
Steve. You're on Talk Radio 1260 AM.
Yes, sir.
A station I played a very instrumental role in getting you on.
Well, a gold star for you.
You can just give me $1 million out of that $60 million you're going to get from them bozos.
In my dreams. That's not going to happen. We're doing that for reasons other than money. Money's never going to be there. But
I hear you.
But, there's... Anyway.
Yeah, my thing that happened, it's not a very long story, but it freaks me out. Freaks me out every night I go to bed. And it's where I'd be laying, sleeping, and I keep my room pretty dark. And then I just felt there was another presence in the room when I'm sleeping. It's dark, but you can still see silhouettes. But anyway, I'd be laying there, and with my eyes closed, I wouldn't be moving. And I'd just thinking to myself, now if I get up really quick and look really fast, if I'm going to see anything, just because I felt something else in there.
Uh-huh.
And I did. I got up really fast.
In other words, you felt the presence of something, and you were intent on surprising it.
Right. Exactly.
Uh-huh.
Because I always had a feeling there was something there. I'm not crazy or nothing, but...
So you jumped up.
I jumped up, looked up really quick, and most of the time there would be nothing there, but this time, back to the red eyes, 2 of them looking right at me.
Red eyes.
Yeah. For about... 2 seconds, maybe, and then they were gone.
Oh, God. So what that really means is that probably most times that you felt a presence that way, when you didn't jump up and look, you now know what was there.
Yeah.
Red eyes.
It's only happened to me twice.
See, it would only take once for me.
Yeah.
Red eyes are not good.
That's what I'm thinking. It's,
yeah, red eyes are definitely not good. I mean, when you think of angels and or heaven or God or the Creator or whatever,
exactly.
You don't think of glowing red eyes. Red eyes are not associated with that side of stuff.
No. That close thing, I can, you know, the Amityville Horror?
Yes.
There's them two red eyes?
Yes.
Yeah, that's like, what I see.
Like that.
Just exactly like that.
I appreciate your call, sir. Thank you. Red eyes are bad. Very bad. It does not take a brain scientist to know that red eyes are not good. That red eyes are not your guardian angel. And now, it's got to make you wonder, doesn't it? How many times have you felt a presence near you? Not a strong feeling, but just a feeling that you were being watched. Next time that happens, why don't you try what that man just did? And sit up real quick and see if you can catch a glimpse of red eyes. If you want to. East of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Yeah, Art.
Yes, hello.
Oh, hey, Art. It's nice to talk to you. My name's Rod, and I'm calling from Haworth, Illinois. And I'm listening to you from WJBC here in Bloomington.
Yes, sir.
And I have a story that's kind of ironic, what this guy was just saying right ahead of me.
The red eyes, you mean?
Yeah. The story I have is a friend of mine was telling me this just a few years ago, and I guess it probably happened within the last 10 years or so, and it happened in a little small town just south of from where I'm calling right now. But I guess there was a family that lived in this house, and there was a mom and a dad and, you know, three little kids, and I guess they were pretty young from what I hear. But I guess one evening, you know, after the kids had gone to bed and the parents were just sitting down watching TV.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, these three kids, they come tearing down the stairs, screaming, you know, "Mommy, Mommy, we saw some red eyes upstairs, you know."
Red eyes.
Yeah. We're scared, you know. And, well, of course, the parents, you know, they really didn't take it seriously, I guess. They just kind of, well, you know, it's okay. Don't worry about it. You know, just try to go back to sleep. I guess they went up, checked everything out, and reassured the kids and everything that everything was going to be fine and everything. And so they went to sleep. I guess it's kind of a tragic tale, but I guess a few days later, the house burned down.
The house burned down.
Yeah, and I guess these three little kids were killed, you know, in the house fire. And so, I don't know, I just thought that was pretty strange.
Well, it is strange, sir, thank you. And again, red eyes. I told you, red eyes are not good. Red eyes are not good. All right, listen, two things, folks. Number one, you may now begin checking my website, because as he receives them, Keith Rowland, my webmaster, is putting the ghost photographs that you're sending, the good ones, up on the website. Now, we'll see what little section he has prepared for that. But no doubt, you'll find a link on the front page. If you have a ghost photograph, a spirit photograph, or a demon photograph, this is the night we are not only collecting, but immediately posting them as we do Ghost to Ghost AM. Now, you may send them to webmaster@artbell.com. That's webmaster@artbell.com. A quick Terrence McKenna update for you. Terrence is now away with his lady friend for a couple of days. It's a location unknown. And I feel quite confident that next week we're going to talk a bit with Terrence McKenna. He has a rather grim prognosis with a malignant brain tumor in his frontal lobe area. But he believes he is not doomed. Those are his words. I spoke with him on the phone. He said, I don't feel doomed. He is a unique individual, and I imagine he has perhaps a different outlook on life right now, something I would love to explore with him on the air, and I think we will in this next week. At any rate, coming back soon with more Ghost to Ghost AM from the high desert. Touch not that dial.
In the Kingdom of Nye, from west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. Or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
You are listening to Ghost AM. And oh, it's a good one. It's a really good one. Shortly, you might want to make your way up to my website at www.artbell.com and see the ghost photographs your fellow callers are sending in this morning as we speak. Keith is getting him up as quick as he can. Don't touch that dial. All right, as soon as we get the first ghost photographs up, and that will be within minutes, you will find them in the newest site editions. No doubt, right above the article from Missoula. So, watch for it there. It will be appearing shortly as we get ghost photographs up. That's what we're talking about this morning. Ghosts. I don't exactly know what a ghost is, but you can begin to make some assumptions as you listen to these stories. On our international line, you are on the air. Where are you calling from, please? Hello?
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Jesse. I'm calling from Japan.
Oh, no kidding. Where in Japan?
Okay, Fukuoka City, which is in Kyushu. Kyushu is I guess the southernmost island of Japan, the largest one outside of Okinawa.
Indeed, I spent a decade on Okinawa.
Yeah, and as you well know, there are lots of ghosts in Okinawa.
Oh, I know, the caves.
That's right. You know, Japan is quite a different world from America, and it's what's interesting about it to me is that so many people accept the existence of ghosts here, and also even encourage the belief in it. You know, Japan is island nation full of ancestor worshippers.
That is precisely right.
In summertime.
That's right. I used to actually go in and participate in some of the ceremonies cleaning bones in caves of ancestors.
That's exactly right. Well, I'm married to a Japanese national here, and we spend a considerable amount of time cleaning the family cemetery and talking about the ancestors, inviting the ancestors to come back to the home. And so this is all part of a very ancient belief going back to the beginning of Shintoism and before, I'm sure. But there are quite a few fascinating ghost stories here in Japan, and one thing I just wanted to share with you this evening is I work at a woman's college in Japan and in Kyushu, close to the city of Fukuoka, and it's built on a battleground. In 1300, two large troops of samurai or warriors fought there, and right across the way from the school is this large, what it is a kind of practice field for the self-defense forces here.
Mm-hmm.
And then they drive trucks around and that sort of stuff. When they built this big field, this big area, and paved it over and that sort of thing, they found these old pieces of armor and bones and that sort of thing. And so every year the town does what they call an Ohardai, which is, you know, they get together and they do a group exorcism of this ground because people, the farmers and the villagers in this small town, see over and over again the spirits dressed in armor of these old warriors who died way back in 1300. And,
can you perhaps help me out here?
Sure.
We are talking about what a ghost really is. Now, you say they exorcise them or have a yearly ceremony to try and release the spirits. Obviously,
that's right.
Obviously, the Japanese, as we do, believe that that the spirit does not leave Earth in many cases.
That's right.
For some reason.
That's right. They encourage, well, this is what I was trying to say earlier, the Japanese encourage the ancestral spirits to stay. They don't send them on. They encourage them to stay and come back. And this is part and parcel of ancestor worship. When a person dies in Japan, they have a cycle. 7 days after the person's death, the family will get together and pray for their safe existence in the other world, and then another 48 days later, the same thing, all the way till 50 years after the death of the person. After 50 years, the ancestral spirit becomes part of the group spirit, if you want to call it that. They call it the kami of the family, and part of a kind of collective consciousness that kind of hovers around the family, I guess.
I understand perfectly. As a matter of fact, many people, sir, in this country are now coming to terms with the existence of this collective consciousness.
Yeah.
But as you point out, the Japanese have thought this to be true for more years than we've been alive.
For centuries.
Yes, indeed.
But to go back to the story, though, of the school, the women's college where I work, the people who work there, the security guards, have seen these phantoms, if you will, these ghosts. And in fact, one Sunday morning, it was a couple years ago, one of the security guards was at his post, and he looked up and saw three or four of these phantoms walking down the road. And, you know, in Japan, a ghost doesn't have feet.
Yes.
And he described it to me as being, you know, a classic Japanese ghost dressed in kabuto and armor and lacking feet, kind of walking together single file down this road.
Oh, brother. All right. Well, listen, I really appreciate your call. And you're married to a Japanese national. What do you do there?
Well, I'm a teacher. I teach American literature at the school. And I've been there now for about, this is the eighth year.
Eighth year. So
yeah.
You should be in the process of turning native.
Well, yes and no. Anyway, but one thing I did want to mention to you, Art, is that I've written a book. And this is not particularly, I'm collecting Japanese ghost stories now, but I've collected stories from my hometown in Westminster, Maryland, North Central Maryland, and it's a collection of folklore and ghost stories from that area. I don't know, may I make a mention of that?
Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we do this?
Yes.
You communicate with me privately, send me a copy of the book, and we'll perhaps have you on as a guest, and then you...
Art, I'd be happy to do that.
All right. I'll look forward to that. Thank you so much for your
call. Thank you, sir, and I'm a great fan of your show.
Thank you, and take care all the way from Japan. Anybody else around the world want to chime in this morning? Our international line, and who knows how really far this line could go, huh? What barriers this line may actually break through? That's the international line. So if you're anywhere outside the country, you really can get through to us toll-free. Did you know that? You can get through to us toll-free. All you do is call your AT&T operator and have her call for you, 800-893-0903. That's 800-893-0903. Already, Keith has put the first photographs up. And you're going to love this one, clearly taken in a cemetery with a freshly dug grave. And above it, you will see, without question, an apparition. This is a copyrighted photograph entitled Sweet Chariot. And I don't know whether that's a sweet chariot or not, but it's one scary photograph taken in a graveyard. We've got that one up now, we've got another up, and we've got additional photographs going up as you send them in. So if you would like to, by all means, and here's another one taken from the USS Arizona. And if you look very carefully into the water, you will see clearly, without question, an apparition in the water. How's that for different? On my website right now at www.artbell.com. And if you have a good ghost photograph, send it now to webmaster, that's Keith Rowland actually, webmaster at artbell.com. That's webmaster at artbell.com, and Keith will get it up for you. Keith keeps the same kind of hours that I do, and so it makes this kind of thing easy to do. Very interactive. West of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello there.
Hi.
Hi. Where are you?
I'm over here in Milan, New Mexico at the Petro truck stop. Name's Wes, truck driver.
You say in New Mexico?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I've been listening to your show going down the road. My hair's been standing straight up, goosebumps the whole nine yards.
Oh, it's been quite a night.
I got a ghost story for you. This I wouldn't believe it, but this little girlfriend of mine was with me, seeing exactly the same thing I seen. This happened back in the late 70s down in Redondo Beach.
Yes, sir.
Out in California. I was up for the weekend. I was in the Navy, and we'd rode up to the store to get a case of beer, go over to a friend of mine's house, and do a little partying. It's just right about sundown, just starting to get dark. We're going down the road on my bike, both of us totally straight and sober.
Yes.
And seeing this thing and like a black kind of like cape run across the road in front of us, and really moving, faster than any person could run.
It was though running like a human being would run. You could see the motion.
No, not really.
No. So more like a fast-moving, floating object.
I would probably say that, yeah.
All right.
Anyways, it took off up in this grass field where the power lines run through, and I turned up in there and went to try to catch it. Well, I started catching up with it, and all of a sudden it spun around, and it looked like a skeleton.
Mm-hmm.
And it took off back the other way.
Mm-hmm.
So I got my bike turned around and chased it back across the field, across the street, up this little alley by this park, and it ducked around this corner of this building.
May I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Why would you chase a skeleton?
I don't know.
If I saw a skeleton, I'd be going the other way. But you chased the skeleton.
I guess...
Now, is that a rational thing to do?
Well, at the time, I guess it must have been. I don't know.
Either that or you weren't rational at that moment. Either way, go ahead.
Well, anyways, it ducked around the corner of this building, and I got up there next to the corner of the building, and it took off back the other way. So in the process of getting my motorcycle turned around again, now there's two people standing there that weren't there before.
Great.
And the girl had long black hair, and she had like on a white gown, and she had real white skin and wire-rimmed glasses.
Mm-hmm.
This guy that was standing next to her had on like a brown trench coat,
like a really old looking old timey suit, brown suit with a frilly shirt.
Right.
And kind of a, you know, like a scissor cut haircut.
Yes, sir.
He had a cane. And I stopped the bike, and this girl reached out and grabbed Roxanne's hands, my girlfriend's hands.
Yes.
And she squeezed them so hard it hurt her for a week. And three times she said, Mama told us not to come out tonight. Three times she said that. When, in the course of events, you know, all going on, I'm asking him, what's this thing up here going, you know, running? And the guy never said a word. He just stood there, you know, looking at us. And we roared off to go try to catch this thing, and it just, poof, disappeared.
Mama told us not to come out tonight, huh?
Yes, she said that three times.
What do you think you encountered?
Well, I got to talking to this one guy that I knew that was kind of into crazy stuff like that, you know, and he told me we encountered something of the supernatural.
Mm-hmm. Crazy, I don't know about crazy. And not easily explained, perhaps, but I don't know about crazy. The one that still bothers me the most tonight is the box with the bones. As a child, going with your play friend to the box with the bones. Underground. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Eric. This is Pat in Minneapolis.
Yes, hi, Pat.
How are you doing tonight?
Well, that's an interesting question. Deserves more time than I have right now to answer it. What's on your mind?
Well, I wanted to tell you the story of my encounter.
All right.
I work for a news station, and several years ago I was at a different station down in Florida.
A radio station.
Television.
Television, okay. Television, yeah. News.
And one morning, very early, I had to go in, and I was supposed to meet someone to go out of town.
Yes.
So I walked into the building around 3 o'clock in the morning, uh-huh. And there was no one else in the building. And I started getting all my stuff together to head out, waiting for the other person to show up.
Sure.
Well, after being there a few minutes, I thought I heard someone else in the building.
Mm-hmm.
So I called out to see if it was my friend that I was supposed to meet. And there was no answer, so I thought, well, maybe I had heard something. Well, a few minutes later, I heard another noise. So again, I called out, and no response. Well, finally, again, a few more minutes, I definitely heard someone in the building. And proceeded to walk around to try and find out who it was. Walked into the next room, which was just off of the newsroom, and saw a girl there. Well, basically looked like she was there, but really strange looking. It didn't look like an actual person.
No? Translucent? Or in what way different than a real person?
Basically, I guess translucent would be a good way of putting it. There, but not solid.
Gotcha.
So I saw this person, and I said hello, and got no answer, and she looked at me, and then turned and started to walk down the hall toward the studio. So I followed, although looking back, I didn't take off and go the other way, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Followed and walked into the studio. Well, when I walked into the studio, the lights were on. All the TV lights, or at least it looked like they were at first.
Right.
And I watched her. She walked up, basically walked up onto the set and sat down, and then looked at me.
Hmm.
And then everything went dark. And I just kind of...
Let me guess. She had been an anchor at some point at this station in the past.
Well, as I found out, and jumping ahead a few weeks later, I asked someone if anyone had ever had a similar experience. And
yes.
Someone said, well, hadn't you heard the story?
The story.
And I said, no, what story? Well, as it turned out, in the late 60s, there had been a girl who worked at the station.
Yes.
Who one night had walked in, walked onto the set, and killed herself.
Oh, my God.
And from then on...
I get the picture. Believe me, sir. Thank you. Killed herself on the stage, huh? Somebody sent me this. Hey, Art. Some ghosts are connected to the work they did during their lives. This being so, when you move on to the other side, hopefully long from now, will we be able to hear you on the radio dial? I'll tell you what, folks. After I'm gone... check it out. Maybe up in the expanded portion of the band one night, you'll hear me saying something about coast to ghost, AF.
Well, call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
It is in the middle of the night, in the dark, Ghost to Ghost AM, nothing but ghost stories all night long from the high desert. And we're adding photographs now on the website quickly as you send them in. Keep checking, keep reloading. New ones are going up just about every few minutes. It's all at www.artbell.com. You know what I heard earlier today on one of the financial channels? I heard that e-commerce, that means business done over the internet this year, exceeded the income of car companies, automobile companies in America. And I find that very difficult to believe. And maybe I got it wrong, but I don't think so. That's a lot of money changing hands over the internet, isn't it? A lot of money. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
Hello, Art. I'm Chris from Minneapolis.
Chris, you're going to have to yell a little. You're not too loud.
Excuse me?
That's all right. Just get real close to the phone. Touch that phone with your lips.
Hey, right then. Hello, Art. I'm here with a couple of buddies. We try to get together every week and listen to your show. I'm calling about three incidences I had a while back. The last one was a while back. Is actually 6 months ago. The first one happened a long time ago, years ago, in a room with my sister. And a little word about, some words about my home before I continue. It was built in the late 1800s,
mm-hmm.
and for a while this fellow named Walter lived there, who died, I believe, in the 60s or something.
Mm-hmm.
And he lived in our home most of his life. Anyway, we're sitting there, and there's this light with two switches to it. And we're both a good 10, 15 feet away from both switches.
Sure.
And the light suddenly turned on. It was, the light switch was off. And so I went down and to investigate. And the switch was on its on position, so you had to turn it, well, it was on its off position, so you had to turn it on in order to turn off the switch, the light, because the other switch is switched.
I understand, a two-switch deal, yeah.
Yeah, so the light, the switch physically moved to turn on the light, which was kind of spooky, because the switch would have to move up to turn off, turn on the light and not move down. And I waited for a while thinking about it, and I went...
Yeah, even imagining that gravity might be at work, it's not going to go up.
Yeah, that's what kind of spooked me.
Hear you.
And this happened again a while later, just a few minutes, and I kind of left the room there, but my sister witnessed that too. It was pretty spooky. The next thing is, in our basement... I only have two other things to say here. The third one's related to the lights. In our basement, we have this exercise bike, which is not too far from the base of the stairs.
Right.
I went down... Pardon me?
I said right.
Oh, sorry. I went downstairs to get something, and I went back up and forgot I had to get something else. So I went back downstairs, and I wasn't quite in the basement. I could see the exercise bike through the little area above the stairs. And... it was moving very slowly, and it started moving faster and faster. And so I ran up, and...
You mean all by itself?
All by itself.
Great.
Oh, yes. Bucket of fun. That was really weird. excuse me, my voice is a bit hoarse. The last thing I have here is I was in the room that this light switch thing happened just 6 months ago, and I was walking by... I looked at the light switch not too far away from it, thinking about what happened, and I was looking at it for about 30-40 seconds, and it turned off.
You watched it?
Yes.
As it turned off?
Well, I didn't actually see it turn off, but I watched the light as the light turned off. It was too fast for me to actually see it move, but the light switch didn't move.
Right.
Well, that's all I have to say.
Those are the three, all right. Well, the one thing that I would dredge from that and wonder about is why a spirit or why a ghost would need exercise. Now, the one thing you would think you would gain when you leave the physical and go to the other side is, you know, we're done with this need for food stuff, right? And exercise, why would a spirit need exercise? Physical exercise, mental maybe, but physical why? So that worries me a little bit. Get over there, hell, you probably have to take vitamins, the way it sounds. West of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Hi, Art, this is Chris in Denver.
Hi, Chris.
And just wanted to relate a little story to you.
You mean like things to do when you're dead in Denver?
Yeah.
Okay.
Several years ago, I lived in a house with my parents in Kansas, and we lived in an old house, and one night I got up late, and I heard drumming in the house.
Drumming?
It was very strange.
That's always good.
I thought it was a next-door neighbor or something.
Drumming.
And I continued to hear this for the next several weeks. So finally, I got up and did a little research at the town records and the local library and things, and come to find out, when the church across next door and the house were built in the late 1800s,
mm-hmm.
that they had been built on an Indian burial ground. The Indian place had been tore up to build these structures. And I was just as shocked as can be.
And was there more or just drums?
Well, that's all I ever saw. My sister claimed to see other things, but I'm not sure, can't confirm that.
Be enough for me. Sure would be enough for me.
Yeah, it was pretty a frightening experience after I learned about this. But that's about all I have to say, so.
Glad you called, sir.
What?
Glad you called, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, goodbye. Let me tell you a humorous little story. I'm going to have to motivate Ramona, who is in the next room. This is not exactly a drum story. As you know, we've done a lot of, and what I'm referring to, hon, if you're listening in there, is the, she knows the sound effects. We were on a trip, and we have taken many over the last few years, you know, to different parts of the world, some rather exotic parts of the world, as a matter of fact. And a lot of times when we've gone with Bob and Sue Crane. They're very good friends of ours. Bob Crane of the Sea Crane Company. Where were we?
We were in Cape Town.
Cape Town, South Africa, that's right. And we were in a beautiful hotel, actually, a beautiful hotel. This is such a funny story. We had gone shopping that day. We'd gone shopping that day, and I don't know, what was it, about 3 or 4 in the morning?
Oh, gosh, no, it was close to 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock in the morning.
It was my birthday.
Your birthday, that's right, it was your birthday. We're in Africa, and Bob and Sue's room was down the hall from us. And we were awake because, you know, you're on a different time schedule, and here we are awake at 5 a.m. And we had acquired this little African thing that I'm holding up right now. You can see it if you're watching on the streaming video. And so I sort of crawled down the hall and got right outside of Bob and Sue's room, knowing they were still asleep, and I let loose with this. I did that for a moment, and pretty soon you hear, "What the hell was that?" And you hear Sue going, "I don't know, what was it? Did you hear that? My God, it sounded like drums." And so I crawled away, you know, and I waited a moment. I came back to their door again a moment later, and I'm... And we're in Africa, and by now they're imagining the worst. You're hearing, "Oh my God, what's outside our door?" And so I ran back to the room, and by now my phone was ringing. My phone was ringing. Bob got on the phone and said, "Oh my God, did you hear that out the hall? Don't go out the hall. You heard it, right?" I said, "No, I didn't hear anything. Nothing. No, it's quiet." And finally, we disengaged the conversation. I went down the hall again. Dead silence from the room. Got them good, man, I tell you. I really got them good. They, if they're listening right now, they'll recall this very well indeed. Yeah, it's better than a cup of coffee, I'll tell you. On the international line, you're on the air. Good morning.
Hello?
Hello there.
Yeah, this is Will from Victoria, listening to you on CFAX 1070, the news authority.
Well, that's the way to do a promo. Do you have a ghost story for us?
Well, it kind of goes back when I was 10 months old at the time, and it's something that my sister and mom would tell me about.
Uh-huh.
And we lived in an old house there, and my dad was maintaining a farm and everything there. And my dad would go out on different trips and stuff. And,
yes.
And they were alone, and I was up in my crib, and my sister and I shared a room, and they were sleeping there. And I guess one night, my sister woke up and went downstairs to my mom and said, "There's a lady in a rocking chair beside my crib." And my mom just says, go lie down and go to sleep. And that's all she said, but my mom had seen the same thing. And it was just a lady sitting in a rocking chair over my crib. And my mom knew that it wasn't a harmful ghost. She got that feeling that it wasn't anything, you know, to worry about.
Yes.
And so she just, you know, let it be. And she had, heard later that apparently there was an old fellow and a wife there living, and the fellow had a heart attack,
right,
and fell on the lady, and she was trapped underneath this husky fellow, and she couldn't get up.
Couldn't move.
No, and she eventually died of suffocation or something like that, and it was not even a month before we moved out of there, and we moved before my dad came back there, so...
I got you. Well, see, that's I think what bothers me more than just about anything else with respect to ghosts is particularly when they die in a way just described. I mean, imagine somebody having a heart attack falling on you and smothering you as they die above you. Bad way to go, huh? Bad way to go. And to be earthbound for whatever period of time after that because of that. It really is discomforting when you consider what may lay over there on the other side. It may not be what we think it is, huh? First time caller line, you're on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
I'm sitting in the dark listening to that gentle baritone voice. I'm Don from Long Beach, California.
Yes, Don.
1964, my wife-to-be at the time, and her girlfriend and I were sitting having a little fun conversation, and a friend pulls out a Ouija board.
Oh, here we go.
Yes, here we go. And the friend knew very little, first time I'd ever met her, knew very little about, or actually knew nothing about the our individual families and backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And I got on the board with her, and we brought up an entity, said it was from Texas, and we were asking questions back and forth, and he said that he had died some time ago, and that he had lost a lot of money, had investments in silver and gold, things like that.
All of this through the Ouija board?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. And
I really have to stop and ask.
Yes.
You know, as you're beginning to get a cogent conversation, a litany even, of this person's life coming from the Ouija board, how the hell could you sit there with your hand on that moving?
At the time I was young.
Yeah.
I was a lot younger than I am now.
Young and dumb.
Young and dumb.
Okay.
Yeah. And also curious. Anyway, as it turned out, we had a family friend, my wife-to-be at the time, and myself, whose name was Tex, and he had committed suicide a couple years before, and he had lost money in a silver mine.
So, there he was.
There he was.
Communicating, I've got to wonder, from way over on some other side, or there in the room with you.
Who knows? By the way, I have both of your autograph books. I've yet to read them due to time constraints, but looking forward to it.
You'll get to them. All right, my friend, thank you so very much. My books, The Art of Talk, which is now in reissue, by the way, or reprinting or whatever they call it. The Quickening, which we're right in the middle of right now. And, of course, the latest with Brad Steiger called The Source. So actually, there are three. Wildcard line, you're on the air. Good morning.
I was just going to say, may the force be with you. Okay, you're going to get mad at me because I called on the wildcard line, and I'm Kathy from Woodbridge, New Jersey.
Well, that's all right.
That's
you're pretty wild. So
I should really call from...
No, you're allowed.
Yeah, how do you know I'm wild, Art?
Well, I don't know. There's just something in your voice.
Yeah, I guess so. My mother was right. Can't fool anybody.
You're a wild one.
Well, in 1984, we purchased the place we're living in right now.
Uh-huh.
As I've told you many times, it's a mobile home. And it wasn't here. They moved it here. The previous place was taken away.
Mm-hmm.
And they had waited from anywhere from a month to two till the place was brought in. And then they said, give it time to settle. You know, no, you can't move into them right away. As they leave the wheels on these things where we live, we're not allowed to take them off. And we waited about 2.5 weeks. And as soon as I walked into the place, I got a really creepy feeling. It wasn't just that I didn't like it. I just didn't want to stay here.
Sure.
And
I know the feeling.
I even went through the thing, is there some way we could get out of the deal? But we had already sold our other place. So there was, I hate to move because I got moved around when I was a kid so much that I like the grass to grow under my feet.
I know that feeling,
you know that
too.
Feeling.
Yeah, you bet
okay.
I do, sure.
So October... And bad feelings, and my daughter was 11 at the time, and she literally did not want to sleep in the bedroom, and no matter what we did, forget about it. So every morning I'd see her on the sofa sleeping in the living room, and this went on for past Christmas time. our bedroom was constantly freezing no matter what we did.
Right.
And this was a bedroom that got the afternoon sun. Couldn't understand it. Till this day, it's cold. There was a black kitten that was on the porch. And no matter what we did, half grown, we could not get this cat to come in the house.
Huh.
The neighbors chilled at us. They did not warm up. They gave us looks. I don't know why. One neighbor told us different things about the block, but never told us who lived here before, or nothing about them. So you go figure. I started to see a strange, tall person. And I mean person. I could describe this person in the dark. Never saw them in the light at night, right before bedtime, and during bed looking out towards the hall.
They didn't have a beret on, did they?
This person, no. This person was over 6'5", like almost 7 foot tall.
Okay.
Then shortly afterwards, there was another person, a female, with the person. Okay?
Yeah, well, that rules out Curtis.
Art, this was all the time. This was way into the summertime. You could see them. You could look into the hallway, as I'm doing now, which is dark, and you could see them looking at you, and you could smell the beginnings of when you light a cigarette. You know the smell?
Do I know the smell?
Yeah, just the little smell.
Yes.
A good smell before you light. And we don't smoke, but I know what it smells like. I miss that smell.
Right.
And then you would smell alcohol, rubbing alcohol. That was in the house almost continuously, to the point where I asked them, what is going on? Is it formaldehyde or is it alcohol?
Okay, almost out of time here.
Well, we found out that these people had committed suicide, both of them. Their little boy had been put into foster care.
Uh-huh.
And it was only 3 months after I had moved in that they got rid of this place because it had the old place that it had bad ill feelings.
Right.
But there is a part two. I had a visitor.
You had a visitor?
I had a visitor.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to hold that for another time because we are out of time for this hour. That's Kathy from Woodbridge, New Jersey. Well, at least it wasn't. I was afraid that story was going to Curtis somehow, but it didn't. I'm Art Bell. Don't touch that dial.
Kingdom of Nye, from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
Good morning, everybody. We're talking about ghosts. They're real, you know. And if you've been listening all night, by now you already know that. There'll be more of it this hour from the high desert. Pretty good memories, actually, connected with this one, you know. Keith Rowland, my esteemed webmaster, informs me we now have Ghostorama up there for you. We have 9, count them, folks, 9 brand new ghost photographs on my website right now. ghost photographs that were sent in tonight. You'll see it right there in the newest, latest items. 9 brand new ghost photographs tonight alone. Where do you see them? www.artbell.com. And as you scroll down, you'll see the listing for the ghosts. 9 brand new photographs tonight. Good going, folks. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm fine.
I'm Mark from Gig Harbor, Washington.
Yes, sir.
And before I relate my ghost story, I just want to tell you how much I enjoy listening to your show. I listen to it every night, laying in bed and reading probably a Graham Hancock book or two.
Well, it's a little different, all right.
And I've been in broadcasting for many years myself, except I went the way of spot sales.
Oh, you're a salesman, radio time salesman.
Well, I started out at 6 o'clock in the morning reading the farm report when I was 17 years old, and went into the sales manager one day and said, I want to sell some spots after 9 o'clock. I've got a free day.
In other words, I want to really make some money.
Yeah, yeah. I noticed in the parking lot that the guys who had the nice cars were the ones who were selling the spots instead of the ones on the air.
Yes, you're quite correct. The people, you know, people think that you're an immediate sensation, you know, because you're syndicated now on almost 500 radio stations. But
right.
I'm an overnight sensation that's been at it for about 30 years.
Yeah, God bless you, Art Bell.
Thank you. Anyway,
my story is I was about 15 years old. And my mom and I had moved into this house, and this was back in the Cleveland area, Cleveland, Ohio area.
Oh, yes.
And it was a typical two-story Victorian kind of house with, you know, the front porch. And they're very set. Their houses are very close set together. And there was this one empty house that was next door and sat a little higher on the hill. And at the time, I guess she was 3 years old or so, sister, she was standing on the back porch, and she was looking up at this old house, this empty old house,
mm-hmm.
and said to my mom, see the man? See the man? He's drinking something in the window.
Mm-hmm.
And we later learned that a guy had died in that house, and he was, you know, alcoholic, and he used to walk up the stairs every night, and you could hear him fall into bed. And my little sister described that. But we were told in the house that we moved into that it, too, was haunted. And, of course, we didn't think anything of it, but it was rather interesting when that happened to my little sister because she couldn't make up that story.
What if, when you die, if you're an alcoholic, your hell is to stay as you are?
What, drunk?
Yeah.
or restricted to 7-Up for the rest of eternity?
No, drunk. Maybe after the first 50 years, after the first several millennium, maybe drunk wouldn't be so good.
Well, I just hope that heaven has at least some single malt scotch.
Well, I can see where you're going.
So anyway, in the house that Mom and I moved into, we were told, because the people that lived there were actually friends of the family, and we were told that the house was haunted, and we said, yeah, ha-ha.
Mm.
And when you go in the house, it was a typical, like I said, old two-story Victorian house. And
right.
As soon as you walk in the front parlor, there was an immediate set of stairs that went up to the second floor to the bedrooms.
Yes.
And there was 3 bedrooms up there and a bathroom. And then there was another door in the hallway there that led up a very tight set of stairs up into the third floor attic.
Sounds like a cool house.
Yeah, it was a very cool house. In fact, it was built in the turn of the century, late 1800s, with wooden pegs, no nails in it. So
a lot of them had secret passageways. I lived in a house once with secret passageways.
Never found a secret passageway, but we started hearing noises in the attic. And you could hear a sound like somebody dragging a trunk across the ceiling floor, or across the ceiling.
Oh, yes.
And my mom would come out of her bedroom window, and she'd knock on my door. Do you hear that?
And I'd say, yeah, I hear that, Mom. And so I one night I had a friend of mine over, Gus, and we went up the stairs, and it was one of these deals where you pull open the door, and there was a string that hung down from way up above that would pull on a, you know, to pull a light.
Sure.
And we pulled on the light, and nothing happened. The light didn't work. So we decided to go up the stairs, and we would take two flashlights. And Gus and I went up the attic stairs, and we got up to the top, and we each had a flashlight in our hand. And up there was also a roll-away bed, one of those old roll-away beds that folds in half. And somehow, this honestly got happened to us. Both of our flashlights went out at exactly the same time, and my belt got caught on one of the springs on that roll-away bed, and it was like... It was like Laurel and Hardy. We both fell down those stairs.
That'd be me, too. See, now, this sounds like a real story to me. Other people chase skeletons. Not me. No, sir. I'm down the steps with you.
We fell down those stairs, and we finally went. I finally went back up a couple of days later and changed that light bulb. And... then I decided, you know, this would be a great place, a groovy place to have my bedroom. I could put my Janis Joplin posters and my Jimi Hendrix posters up here and over here. And
so you did.
And I did. I made a bedroom up there.
Okay, we don't have a lot of time.
Well, anyway, speed it up here. I started sensing that somebody was in the room with me.
Right.
Things would happen. The car keys would disappear and then reappear.
Mine do all the time.
Yeah. You could smell flowers. You could smell things. And there was a... At first, it was like a pleasant presence of a... like it felt like a feminine presence. And then it became very oppressive. And it was like a... I had to move back downstairs.
You had to move out of the room.
Yeah, I had to move out of the attic. It was a great place to have a room... At 15 years of age, 16 years of age, but it was haunted. Yeah, yeah.
I've got you, sir. Thank you. I lived in a in a very unusual house. We were near a place called Fort Ritchie, Maryland, in Blue Ridge Summit, Pennsylvania, and the Mason-Dixon line actually crossed through our house. Actually crossed right through our house, so you could, depending on what part. We had a lot of trouble with taxes, where we paid taxes. But the Mason-Dixon line cut through the house. And this house was up on top of a mountain. It was a very, very, very large house, 35 rooms. An architecture that my mother called early Halloween. I mean, this place looked like your classic ghost house. And it had secret passageways. When I was young, well, we had a lot of fun with those. And the secret passageways were left over from the days of slave trade, when people, Southerners, who were sympathetic to freedom for the slaves, had a kind of a system where they got them from the South to the North. And this house had been one of those houses. And as a result, there were secret passageways everywhere, behind walls. It was really cool. Wasn't haunted. I never met a ghost there. But as a teenager, I spent a lot of time in those secret passageways. They were really cool. Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art. This is Brian in Philadelphia, listening to 1210 WPHT.
What a monster radio station that is.
Yeah, I just have trouble getting it where I'm at.
Uh-huh.
At the moment.
People, on the other hand, in Nova Scotia, they receive it just fine.
Well, I'm deep in the bowels of a building.
Yeah,
and,
I got
to put the radio outside the door. And
oh, boy.
It's pretty crazy here.
You know, there is a solution for that.
Yeah.
And Bob Crane has got it.
I was going to ask you that.
Yeah, it's a little tiny FM transmitter. And what you do is hook it up to your AM radio, and it will then transmit on FM in perfect clarity. So you put a second radio inside and you listen on FM.
So what would you you be tuned in under?
In other words, you're retransmitting the AM signal that your radio is receiving outside.
Okay.
And you're retransmitting it on FM. So you just set it to a spot on the FM dial. You got actually a little transmitter.
Oh, wow.
And it's clear as a bell.
No pun intended.
No pun intended. Anyway.
Yeah. I'm not sure what kind of story this is exactly, but I consider it a ghost story.
All right.
And I guess like most ghost stories, the real creepiness doesn't kick in till the punchline, and it scares the heebie-jeebies out of me.
Go.
This happened about 10 years ago. At 10, 11, my grandmother died. I was never really particularly close to her. And about 3 days, I was having a lot of trouble reconciling with the grief, and about 3 days afterwards, I had this dream, and initially, if it wasn't for the punchline, I would just dismiss this as a dream.
Sure.
It's one of those dreams where you dream that it's morning and you're waking up.
Oh, I've done that.
I hate those kind of dreams.
I've done that. I've actually done that.
Yeah, it's like the dream pulls a trick on you, and
yep.
You get up and you think you're going about your morning.
That's right.
And there was a knock at the door, at my bedroom door, and my dad saying, oh, someone's downstairs.
Actually, it's disorienting.
Yes. Yeah, well, it's disorienting when you actually wake up and it's still dark.
Yeah, and so, yeah, that's right. And so at that moment, the knock comes.
Yeah, knock, and it's my dad at the door, and he's getting ready to get in the shower, and he's like, there's someone downstairs. And I go downstairs, and there's a buddy of mine saying my grandmother had come to his house and asked to be driven here. And he came in, but my grandmother refused to come in. She was standing out at the door.
Yeah.
And so I go to the door, and there's my grandmother looking older and more haggard than I had ever remembered her looking.
Yes.
And she's in bare feet, and it's snowing, and it was fall when she died. We had no snow. And she's, like, scratching on the glass. And I, like, go, and I see her, and I'm shocked. And she just says, Brian, let me in.
Oh, no.
I just got really, really spooked by that, and I'm, like, just standing there saying, come in yourself. And she's like, no, let me in. And I refused to do that, and finally just went, you are not my grandmother. And I closed the door on her, and she started scratching on the glass going, there is no heaven, there is no heaven. And it really, really spooked me out. And I went in, and my friend gave me some kind of comment about, man, you're really cold or something like that. And I went upstairs, and at the top of the steps, there was my father in a dripping wet towel because he'd gotten out of the shower, and he just said, who was that? And it was his mother that had died, and I just broke down crying and all of a sudden woke up.
Oh my God.
I woke up, and it was the middle of the night, and I'm just shaking in bed, and I'm like, oh, man, that was really, really scary. And it bothered me for a couple of days, and I finally decided to mention it to the family.
Yes.
And when I mentioned it, my father got real, real quiet. And he said, 20 years before, when I was like 3, maybe 4 years old, we had had this neighbor that lived next door who would, she was a, this old woman who had never married, and she had gone a little loopy, and her relatives had carted her off to an institution.
Yes.
And my father relayed, he had a dream one night that he heard a pounding on the door, and he got up out of bed, and he went to the upstairs window, and he leaned out, and there was old Miss Esther scratching on the glass, begging to be let in.
Oh, God.
And his only response to her was, you are not Miss Esther. And he closed the window on her, and he went back to bed, and then, of course, woke up himself. A few days after that, he was at the supermarket, and he ran into Miss Esther's brother, who told her, oh, my sister just passed away this week.
Oh, brother.
I don't know what to make of that. I don't believe it was the actual spirit.
Just out of curiosity,
yeah.
Had you let her in? what do you think would have happened?
That is something that has just racked my brain for 10 years. Had either my father 30 years ago or myself 10 years ago actually said, yes, come in, the consequences really, really freak me out.
Or worse yet, have you done something sinfully wrong by not letting her in?
Yeah, well, there was just this overwhelming feeling of that is something that is very wrong. It was just, there was an all-pervasive, like when I said to it, you are not my grandmother, it was not out of fear, it was not out of like, oh, I don't want to deal with this. There was a sense of, this is something masquerading.
I got you, and I can't handle it anymore. Good night.
Okay, Art.
Oh, man, scratching at the window. Let me in.
Huh. Mama said there'll be days like this, there'll be days like this, Mama said.
Romance in our hands, heaven's holding a half moon, shining just for us. Let's slip off to a sand dune real soon, kick up a little dust.
Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
From actually very serious cactus country out here, indeed. I don't think too many programs come from this part of the world, but we do. This is kind of interesting. From Charleston, South Carolina, which is a pretty spooky place, I'd like to say anyway. Hi, Art. My husband and I loved having this little black cat named Bucky in our lives for 15 years. She was correctly labeled as intuitive, intelligent, funny, and loving by many. She passed away last January. After her death, I instinctively told my husband that we would never find a soul as special as hers if we took in 100 cats. And that's when the felines began inundating us. Well, we took many pictures of the first group of four premature kittens that we bottle-raised, and in the upper corner of one is a fuzzy, cloudy shape that is easily recognized as Bucky, sitting upright with her tail smugly wrapped around her body. We'll send you the picture today. We're now up to 11 new cats and kittens now. It seems an appropriate loving prank that she's been able to play on us after her departure from this life. Kathy and Michael in Charleston, South Carolina. Yeah, I buy that one all the way. Cats are as individual and full of soul as we are. And that may apply to other animals. I'm, as you know, a cat fancier, and so would they make themselves apparent after this life? Oh, yes, indeed. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Art.
Yes.
This is Sterling from Oregon.
Yes, Sterling.
Got a good one. This one happened when I was about 14. We lived in a church.
You lived in a church?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it was my... we had moved to Alaska to a town, and my dad was a caretaker of this really, really large church, and so we lived inside of it.
Okay.
And they had like in a little apartment. It was all attached to the side of it.
Now, one would think a church would be a relatively safe place to live.
Oh, yeah. you would, but no.
No.
It started like, I don't know, probably 4 months after we got there. You'd hear people like knock on the door. And so you'd go to the door and answer it, and there's nobody there.
Nobody there.
And they had the typical church doors where, you know, you have the push bar and you have the little window that's probably a foot long and 6 inches wide. So you can look through, you know, and so you shut the door and you turn around and boom, 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 on the door again. And you spin back around, you're looking out through the door and there's nobody there. And so I'm like, okay. So I start, you know, telling my parents, you know, that really weird things are going on, you know, and they're like, well, you know, just keep it quiet. You know, it's probably just kids playing jokes, you know, and
of course
all this. And, so then I started going down one night when it got really bad. It started getting like worse towards the end of the summer going into the winter. It started getting really, really bad. And I walked downstairs. My mom told me to go get my dad. So I was going downstairs one night, and I passed by the youth pastor's office, and I just glanced in. Well, here's this black ghost of a figure, and I said, the only thing I can ever equate it out is, I don't know if you remember the old Equalizer, that show that used to be on TV.
I do.
The Equalizer. Remember how he stood in front of that car?
Yes.
In front of that car in the beginning of the show?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's what this thing kind of looked like.
This is in the counselor's office.
Yeah, in the youth pastor's office.
Pastor's, yes. Uh-huh.
And I, you know, I would see just kind of this outline of this person, you know, and you could tell it looked like a person, and you could see kind of, I don't know, it's really hard to describe, because you could tell it was a person, you could see his face, but yet it wasn't real distinct. And then he would just kind of be crouched down, and then he would just kind of shake his head like no.
Yes.
You know, and just kind of shake his head and look away.
Yes.
And then he would disappear, you know. And I saw this guy like, oh man, dozens of times. And every single time after he would disappear, I would think, okay, next time I'm going to ask him where he comes from or why he's here or something, you know. And then a few days later, I would see him, and you'd be standing there just going, say something, stupid, and nothing would come out of your mouth, you know.
Yeah, you're in shock.
Yeah, you're kind of like frozen, and my brain is thinking, ask him where he's from.
Yes.
And then your mouth is going, yeah, okay. And you just can't talk, and it just got so outrageous. They had built me a room, because the house was only designed for just a family with no children. So they had built my room off one of the end of the classrooms upstairs.
Right.
And that's when all heck tore loose.
What do you mean by that?
Well, the church was kind of in a big octagon shape.
Yes.
And so because of fire code, they had to put a door from our apartment into my room, and then also a door on the opposite side,
right,
so people could pass through if there was a fire. Well, this door was right adjacent to a classroom, and I'd lay down, oh, I don't know, 1 o'clock or so at night, you know, you'd be sitting there listening to the radio or whatever, you know, like this, and all of a sudden you'd hear just tables and chairs and stuff just being thrown all over the place. Sounded like somebody was demolitioning the room. You know, and so you'd go like this. I'd go over to the door, and I'd open up the door, and you'd look, and you'd think you're losing your mind.
Yes.
There's nothing out of place, nothing going on. You'd shut the door, and then you're standing 6 inches from the door, and the doorknob's rattling back and forth, the door's banging in the latch,
kind
of a loose-fitting door, you know, and they're just, it's just going bang, 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 bang,
oh,
bang,
man.
Like this, and you're like, and
wow.
So you grab the knob, and I'm almost shaking, telling you the story again, because it was such a thing when I, especially being that age, it was just quite a traumatic thing. But you'd grab it, swing it open, and there's just nothing there.
Nothing there.
You know, and it perpetually got worse and worse and worse. Finally, I just wouldn't sleep in that room anymore. I'd sleep over on the living room floor, and then they decided, because the living room was attached right to the kitchen, so then this thing or things or whatever decided that the kitchen door was the door to play with now, and they went to the kitchen door and rattled that all night long.
How long did you have to put up with this?
Oh, my gosh. Well, till they moved me to Wisconsin. They sent me to go live with my uncle in Wisconsin, so I was... Oh, man, it was... let's see, we moved there July of 83, and I left... August, September of 84, so a little over a year.
I got you. All right, well, that's horrible. Horrible. The only thing that could be worse would be the special effects you see in horror movies where a wood door bows inward. But, I mean, to sit there shaking with a knob going back and forth and then to grab it and open it and have nothing be there, I couldn't go through that. Well, once again, you as an audience have outdone yourself, and we have selected 9 brand-new ghost photographs sent tonight, this very night, to Keith Rowland, my webmaster, and they're on the website right now. Not one, not two, not five, but 9 brand new ghost photographs of varying scary intensity. So you're welcome to go look. They're on the website right now, www.artbell.com. If you don't get in tonight, then get in tomorrow. Wildcard Line, you're on Ghost to Ghost AM with Art Bell. Hi.
Good morning, Art. This is Craig from Northern California, listening to you on KSRO 1350.
Craig, welcome. Speak good and loud for me.
Okay. Your callers have scared me pretty good tonight. I was driving down the 101 freeway. I don't know if you're aware of Northern California freeways.
I know about 101. I even know about 1, that twisty little thing that goes through the fog.
Yeah, I was coming back from Eureka here back to Santa Rosa from a business trip, and it's, you know, pretty dark out there on the 101, and your callers are talking about red eyes.
That's right.
All these things, and it started burying me deeper and deeper in my seat as I'm driving down the road.
Yeah.
Looking in my rearview mirror, there's red lights, and fortunate for me, it wasn't the supernatural. It was the California Highway Patrol reminding me to slow down. Nice officer, didn't give me a ticket. I told him what I was listening to anyhow. But the story that I have for you is as true as I can believe. It was told to me about 10 years ago by a Boy Scout leader of mine. I was in a Boy Scout troop when I was younger, through a Mormon church. This was a Mormon guy, real nice guy. And he took us up to Philmont, New Mexico, on a trek, about an 80-mile trek into the mountains. And we were up above the tree line about 11, 12,000 feet in the air.
Mm-hmm.
And one night we were telling stories. This is about the fourth or fifth night into the trip, and we were all pretty worn out, and he was telling me he's a Hawaiian guy. His name is Alton, and he come over to the United States when he was a teenager, and he was telling me this story. Him and a friend, when he was younger, about 14 or 15 or 16, I guess he'd just gotten his driver's license, took a couple of girls out on a date, and they decided to scare him. They were going to give him a good scare, so they took him to a cemetery in Hawaii. And, if you know anything about Hawaiian cemeteries, they're very sacred places, and people leave food for the deceased, and you don't touch the food, you don't walk on the graves.
That's right.
Several other things. And so they left the car. They pulled up to the cemetery and left the car and ran around the other side of the cemetery, and we're going to sneak up on the girls in the back of, I guess it was like a 5140, he was telling me, a huge car. And as they came up behind it, they thought the girls were laughing in the back seat. They were, the car was kind of rocking back and forth, and as they got closer, they could tell they weren't laughing, that they were actually screaming.
Uh-huh.
And so they couldn't, they ran up to the car, and at this point, the car was going end on end, side to side. The tires coming actually up off the ground the way he was describing.
Oh, my.
They finally get the car door open. They couldn't open the door. I mean, they tried for minutes, and finally the car stopped shaking. They open the door, and their girlfriends were frantic, talking about red eyes. There was red eyes just all in the windows, and they were just totally frantic. They got in the car, and they drove home. immediately. Well, when they got home, my friend Alden noticed he felt some pain underneath his sock, and he pulled back his sock, and there was a bite mark on his ankle.
A bite mark?
A bite mark. And he thought, oh, I must have tripped, I must have hit something. And the next morning, he lived with his father and his grandfather, and his grandfather was an old Hawaiian, kind of like a medicine man, a very wise old man. He was telling his grandpa what had happened. He was laughing about it, and his grandpa said, that's bad stuff.
Yes, it is.
You've got to make amends for what you did, and that is a bite mark that you have. Well, his older brother, Alden's older brother, was in the same room when his grandfather was describing what he had done. And his older brother, really, the way Alden described it to me, disliked being Hawaiian. He disliked his culture and, said, oh, you guys are full of beans, that there's no such thing as those types of things. And that later that night, his older brother had talked him into going back to the cemetery, and Alden reluctantly went. And they ran all over the cemetery from one end to the other, over graves, kicking over food, the whole nine yards. And when they got back, his brother had a lot of pain, like Alden had felt. And they woke up their mom, and mom came in the room, and he took down his pants, and they counted over 200 bites all over his body. In fact, he had to go to the hospital to have some of these sewn up. And
you're sure of this?
Yes, I kind of have some proof of it. The doctor at this particular hospital, the way Alton describes it to me, was a white man from continental United States, and he was about ready to call the police. He said, look, obviously there's abuse going on in the house. I don't believe your, put-on story of ghosts biting you and such.
Yep.
So he, in fact, called a local police chief who came out. He was a Hawaiian himself, and he knew exactly what that was from. And, no charges were pressed, but Alton was also bitten again in the hip, and where he needed to have several stitches. And to this day, he still has that bite mark in both his ankle, very deep, and she showed them both to me. And I mean, they are bite marks. They are teeth marks. You can see the indentations of the individual teeth. And in fact, he says he doesn't have too much contact with his brother to this day, but he told me that, in fact, when he talks to his brother still talks about, he doesn't wear a lot, he doesn't wear shorts because he's embarrassed of the scars all over his legs that he received from that. But
I tell you, even going back in your story to coming up on a car, literally shaking with its tires coming off the ground on each side and girls inside screaming.
Right.
Could I go up to that car? Could I open that door? I think tough luck, girls. I'm out of there.
I think I would agree with you. I mean, he wasn't aware of the folklore until, after, he had talked to his grandfather. I went to Hawaii when I was about 10 or 11, and my family and I had toured some cemeteries, and I remember specifically the guide saying, stay on the path, never touch the food. And it was the funniest thing I've ever seen. People put McDonald's bags with, quarter pounder with cheese next to the gravesites because they believe that the deceased still eat and need food and water and drink, and they need company and conversation.
Well, I can understand that. A good quarter pounder every now and then, here or there, would certainly make sense. Do you have any idea, just out of curiosity, why so many stories like this come from the islands? Why there are so many Hawaiian stories?
Well, you're talking about a culture of, several hundred, if not thousands of years. I mean, we are all mutts from other nations where they had their culture and we were displaced when we came here on boats. Those people have, several hundred, if not thousands of years of written culture and ideals and stories where we really don't. I mean, we're basically the newest country in the world. We're, not even 300 years old, so we haven't really had the time to put together our stories and our folklore and such.
Well, that's true, and it's a good point, and I certainly appreciate your call, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bell.
And the vision of that car rocking back and forth to the degree that its tires are coming off the road, the surface, with two girls screaming inside, that'll be with me for a while. And this whole thing about red eyes, glowing red eyes, it comes up again and again and again when we do nights like we have done tonight. So tonight, when you get home, or if you're on the road, I'd keep an extra eye out for those red eyes. That's never good. Red eyes are never good. Well, listen, folks, I'm sorry to say that's it for tonight. Don't forget we've got nine new ghost photographs from just tonight on the website, www.artbell.com. Now, tomorrow night, you're going to definitely want to listen, because a good friend of mine, Mike Murphy, who's done the same kind of material that I've been doing for years on KCMO in Kansas City, is going to be filling in. I think you'll find it a fascinating experience. He's going to have Mark Davenport here, and it's going to be a good night. That's Mike Murphy tomorrow night on Coast. I'm Art Bell for now. Night all.